I'd like to begin, as I'm now talking about the eastern part of the Arab world, that is east of Suez, by making two points. One is that one of the basic differences between the eastern and the western parts of the Arab world is that the western part contains relatively homogeneous populations with long histories of state systems and constitutions and so on. Whereas the eastern part of the Arab world is much more confused and divided. And if there is a structure there, it comes from two historical developments. One is a kind of sectarian geography, whereby the eastern part of the Arab world was ruled for a long time by Sunni Muslim dynasties. But it contained what were very often heretical and minority Shi'i communities, which took refuge in two mountains, one just east of, just west of Beirut, and another in northern Iraq. And in fact, the Middle East is now ruled by dynasties that grew up in these mountain districts and were essentially opposed to the Sunni rulers of the plains, but infiltrated the major parts of the Middle East. The second is that after the Second World War, after the First World War, I'm sorry, when the Ottoman Empire collapsed, which had ruled this part of the world, the Arab provinces, for 300 years, the victors in the First World War, the French and the British, divided the area up into something called Iraq and something called Syria and something called Lebanon and something called Jordan and something called Palestine, which have some kind of historical raison d'être, but are also in some senses new and artificial enterprises. So one is dealing with states which have had only a recent history of government, and although they do represent a sense of something that one might call Syrianness and Iraqiness, in that if you talk to Syrians, they talk Arabic in a different kind of way, and they have a different kind of cooking and so on, and different jokes. But nevertheless, it is not an area which has, when can be said to have settled down, and it is interesting to see people like Tom Friedman and others calling for a return to the Sykes-Picot Agreement and wondering whether the ways in which the eastern half of the Arab world was carved up into these particular state systems, whether we should review that. The next point I want to make is that although the Arab Spring was present in the eastern part of the Arab world, it was met by a variety of responses. Those states that had sufficient money sought to buy off their populations by providing jobs and welfare and so on in the way of Saudi Arabia. And that largely worked. But in two very important places, the governments felt sufficiently threatened by the Arab Spring and its possibilities to resist. And that is Syria. This is Syria and Bahrain, and this is where the main problems exist. Entrenched dynasties that are convinced that if the popular movements had worked their way through the system, they themselves would have had to disappear. So they're digging in. So I'd say something a bit about the history of that in Syria and Bahrain, and then somewhere where we are at the moment. So the Syrian government, it is safe to say, in its rather myopic way, was surprised by the peaceful popular protests every Friday and willing to consider reform, but only from a position of strength. That is when it felt that the demonstrations had subsided. And then sometime in 2011, the demonstrations, which had been after Friday prayers and relatively peaceful, we enter the month of Ramadan, and the opposition was faced with the possibility of daily protests, because that is the nature of Ramadan. Everybody goes to prayer in the evening, and therefore decided to dig in and meet peaceful protests with a violent response. And since then, the confrontation has been extended, with the regime using all of its powerful arsenal. It has an extremely effective air force equipped with Russian planes and tanks and so on, and also Scud missiles. While the opposition extends and develops guerrilla tactics and a hit-and-run effect and on the regular forces, and that's sort of roughly where we are at the moment with the opposition, with the government in power in certain places, having surrendered other places to a variety of militias, some of them of a religious component, all of them funded from their friends in the Gulf and other places who feel that the Assad regime is an unsatisfactory regime for an Arab Sunni country. But these various groups are hardly connected. There's no real government in exile with close connections to those inside. So we have money and fighters from various sources, and any of you who read a recent very interesting article in the London Review of Books about how to start a battalion was a very good illustration of how if you are a tough guy, and everybody in Iraq and Syria are tough guys in the sense that they're, whatever you may think about these rulers, they made no effort to disarm their population. So AK-47, the Kalashnikovs are everywhere. So it's quite easy for almost anybody to start a militia, send back pictures by cell phone to well-meaning people in the Gulf and get supported and send in their request for weapons. But there is a limit to the weapons that have come in. And the one thing that the rebels desperately need are Stingers and surface-to-air missiles to bring down the air force and the helicopters. And there has been, until recently, a particular desire by the United States and I think by the Israelis to prevent these weapons getting into the hands of anybody in Syria because they would reduce command of the air. But there is some notion at the moment that some surface-to-aircraft missiles are getting in, a Russian variant of the Stinger. Stingers were used to enormous effect in Afghanistan, was regarded as so dangerous by the United States that they kept a log of every single Stinger that had ever been produced and went around the world trying to get them back into safe hands, because they know that you or I or anybody else who has the strength to point something into the air with a Stinger, it is a heat-seeking weapon and can bring down helicopters and, in some cases, aircraft. So they're very, very dangerous. But the balance is slowly shifting. More and more of these are getting into rebel hands, but it hasn't worked so far. So there's a stalemate, and it's interesting that Washington is, and I think probably London and everybody else, has assumed that the Assad regime must fall at some stage, but nobody knows exactly when that will be. So we jump to what an end game might be, and there is a considerable discussion about what an end game might be. And the two aims of this is somehow or other to preserve a Syrian state structure which can be used to govern the country rather than the country falling into separate bits for the time being. And the other is the standard way of dealing with a refugee crisis is to get the refugees back. And so the end game is how you move from the present confusion through the fall of the Assad regime to a government that can maintain some kind of structure, some kind of law and order, and permit the over a million of refugees return to their homes. I mean, I think nobody can contemplate the fact that after the Palestinians in 1948-49, the Middle East contains another large refugee community housed in camps or somewhere or other, and that they must be allowed to return to stable homes. I'll finish with a few words on Bahrain. There we have a long time resurrection among, insurrection, I'm sorry, among the Shia majority against the Sunni rulers. Resurrection is a word, as Malika, that is the meaning of the word, Nahda and Ba'ath and so on. It's a But in this case, it's an insurrection among the Shi'i majority against the Sunni rulers. The ruling family is divided, but the hardliners decided that the spring should not be allowed to overflow into Bahrain, quite stupidly, I think. It had its own indigenous origins of a group that was actually a majority but was felt like it was being treated by a minority. And this has become a major embarrassment to the United States. Bahrain is a major port for the fleet the Fifth Fleet. And there is now concerted pressure, very obviously day to day, if you look about it, on the Bahrain government to settle. Because the fear, I think, is that if the Syrian regime falls and its major ally, the Iranians, feel that this is a serious defeat, they will then make trouble in Bahrain and other places. So that's a sort of vague glimpse of where the policymakers fear the future may be in advance of the fall of the Assad regime. Thank you.